It's very humbling for me to introduce Rav Tendler, Rabbi Dr. Moshe Tendler Shlita. So I apologize in advance. Rabbi Tendler Shlita is widely recognized as one of our leading poskim of our generation. I believe Rabbi Tendler, and correct me if I'm wrong, Rabbi, that he was the first American-born Yeshiva University Musmach to serve as a Gemara Shir Rebbe at YU. Isn't that correct? Yes. And it's a position that he's
held. Long ago to remember.
It's a position that he's held and continues to hold even today, as soon as today, Ad Me'av Yisrim Shana. Rabbi Tendler Shlita is also one of the pioneers of medical ethics. In 1953, he began teaching a course at Yeshiva College on medical ethics that led to the publication of a book called The Compendium of Jewish Medical Ethics, a book that was widely distributed to hospitals and Jewish organizations. Since then, he continues to teach, write, and lecture extensively on medical ethics and human reproduction and halacha. Rabbi Tendler Shlita serves a unique position as a posek, as a mora haora and dayan, using his extensive halachic knowledge and scientific research experience to wisely advise our people on how to resolve bioethical dilemmas. On a personal level, to me and to all of the students, he serves as a warm and caring role model who integrates science, halacha, and musar and providing clarity in Torah within a framework that highlights the kedusha, or the sanctity, of the family and the community. So it's a great pleasure for me to introduce you, Rabbi Moshe Dr. Tendler Shlita.
I don't know how many of you people know the special schus that I've had. Of having Dr. Loiki, Hashem Yishmerehu V'Yatzileu, as a partner in studying and analyzing as new issues arise that are on the interface of halacha and science. Special schus, special pleasure to have a Talmud Chober that you can count on to have done all the work before he's come to me, and makes it so much easier. It makes it sound as if I am also a contributor, but really, when it's two parts of a whole, a half doesn't count. I decided, despite the title that's in the announcement there, decided to broaden my presentation and try to point out the halachic parameters that are not well understood. We had the special grace of Kodesh Baruch Hu that in our days, Kodesh Baruch Hu revealed secrets of nature. So much has happened the last 100 years. It's almost impossible to understand what our predecessors know about God and nature. So little was known. Stop to think. I have at home a Merck manual. Merck manual of 100 years ago. You know, the Merck manual is a little abrupt review book, and you can find little things there about everything in medicine. And the 100th anniversary, which was some 10 years ago, they published their first manual and the most recent manual. The first manual had, I believe, about 114 pages in it. The new manual, the number started, then ended up in the 3,000. In the first manual, all you had was some plant extracts that were used to treat all kinds of disease. And suddenly, in Kadosh Baruch Hu, was Megales Ateva, opened up some of the secrets and allowed us to peek inside and asked us to do something about it to benefit mankind. Flam mentioned that Kadosh Baruch Hu permitted us when he said, "Pru vu milu es ores v'chibshuha, go and conquer my world." And the Raman says, "Divert my streams, uproot my mountains." It's your world. It's a minig, a custom in our family, when we say Kiddush Friday night, we say Asher Bora Elokim, and we pause, and then say Lasos. Asher Bora Elokim, that God created, and Lasos for us to do. God gave us an unfinished world. We have to finish it. Look what's happened while we weren't looking. Just listed cloning, stem cells, gene editing, and synthetic biology. I'll just comment on the last one. It's not to be believed, the chutzpah, the audacity of mankind. Synthetic biology thinks, and most likely can prove it, that we can put together a living cell, starting with things that are on the shelf, starting with chemicals off the shelf, things that we made ourselves. Yeah. In order for us to fulfill our obligations, our problem is one usually of time. We have difficulty doing what we have to do in order to understand what Kadosh Baruch Hu wants of us. The Torah makes full-time demands. Science makes full-time demands. I take some comfort from the women folk when they have their first child. They give up all their time to the care of the child. They have a second child, they give up all their time for the second time. And the third child, all the time for the third child. Where did they get time for the second child when they gave up all the time for the first child? Baruch Hashem, we managed to find time. In order to do so, you have to invest time. Now, my complaint right now, it isn't easy to find an audience to discuss these topics. It's almost impossible to find a colleague, someone whose opinion comes from a deep study of Torah, with whom you can discuss these modern scientific topics. There's nobody around to talk to. And therefore, sometimes conclusions are reached in halacha that are deviant. That is not what Kadosh Baruch Hu wants us to say. It's a wonderful quote from the Gaon. The Gaon had a Talmud, Reboch Mishklov. The Vilna Gaon, he's quoted by his Talmud. Ki kifi ma'ashech yechzel la'odom yidiyos mishare ha'chochmos, lumazeh yechzel lo meyo yodos b'chochmos ha'tola. I'll introduce that. It's Hanukkah today. Tonight is Hanukkah. The menorah will be seen in many windows or maybe outside their homes. The Nitziv and Baal Osra es Haneros, referring to the menorah. Nitziv says that the menorah, the seven armed candelabra, represented all of human knowledge. The six menorahs represented all of secular knowledge. And the central one represented Torah knowledge. I'll quote his and then what the Gaon said. It's nothing more than an elaboration of what the Gaon said. What the Gaon said was that if you don't understand the six, you will not understand the seventh. But if you understand the six without the seventh, it doesn't pay to understand. There's nothing to be here. All of science is necessary to understand the Torah. And the Vilna Gaon, in his day, was the greatest Torah authority. But also, you remember, he wrote a text on non-Euclidean geometry. That combination is hard to find today. But the truth is that you cannot speak in the name of halacha without understanding as well as any other scientist would understand. And I have there up for you the just comments from the Gemara. The Gemara in Chulin, they didn't know, sitting in the yeshiva, you don't know what's doing out in the field. You have to go out in the field to find out. So Gemara Chulin mentions how dependent they were on the people in the field, right? When it came to identifying kosher birds, difficult because kosher birds do not have that simple sign that Kadosh Baruch Hu gave of chewing the cud and split hoof. And nowadays, our battle's still going on. And I just had a call Erev Shabbos from Ari Greenspan, who's of Tcheles Tzitzis fame, but he's also been doing every year running a Sudas Halacha, where he feeds the people things that he thinks is not kosher. And he's trying to get a clean statement on pheasant, whether pheasant is a kosher bird or not a kosher bird. Yeah. So this summer I went with him to visit one of the gedolim of the Sfarashe community, Harav Machput, a great, great tzaddik, great, tremendous, tremendous expert on trefos, the shrita, trefos, etc. And he confirmed that in his community, pheasant is eaten, it should be a kosher bird. I assure you, when they will serve the peasant, if they, as he's planning to do so, most of the people will not be eating it there. Why? Because the mother didn't serve it to them, so they're not sure whether the rabbis are right. Wonderful Gemara there, the great Rav. Rav is, you people know the the genealogy of the people who wrote the Talmud. Rav was an Amora, a later generation, but he had the authority to dispute with the Tanoim, with the earlier generation. And he was out 18 months in order to study Mumim, what makes a Bechor, a firstborn animal, what makes it no longer having the sanctity of a firstborn, because it developed an injury that's permanent. How do you differentiate a wound from permanent and non-permanent? Couldn't do that by looking in the Gemara. So he went out into the field and studied. And then the wonderful quote from the Moranida, Rav Zeira said he doesn't want to discuss an area of halacha. Rav Zeira was the greatest of his generation because, and the language says, Tiva de Bovo lo gemilno. I don't understand the science behind it that the Babylonians have already mastered. Therefore, I'd rather not involve myself in the halacha of that issue. I put this up there only because Dr. Loike was kind enough to give me that pretty slide, and it's just too nice not to show it. You all seen such a slide, the DNA, the molecule of life. And here's something that was mentioned by a previous speaker. A mother is not an incubator only. One of the big issues in halacha today is, will the real mother stand up? Who is the mother? When you're dealing with a ovum transfer from one individual to the next, who should be considered to be the mother? So this has been one of the sad, it's a sad record of halacha, because for 22 years, dominated by the great posek Rav Al Yoshev, Zecher Tzadik Levracha, they ruled that the gestational mother is the true mother. An egg was donated, mother couldn't provide the egg, but she provided the 9 months of gestation. Who is the mother? It was accepted for 22 years that the gestational mother is the mother. And then they discovered DNA. Suddenly, Rav Al Yoshev was aware there's something called DNA, and he switched. He changed the psak. Right? During that 22-year period, children that were produced by an egg from a non-Jewish woman, gestated by a Jewish woman, was declared to be Jewish. But now he changed the mind, and now we have to declare them non-Jewish. They have to go through a conversion process. Some of them have married already. Their children have to go through a conversion process. Yeah. And this is, I want you to know, not an uncommon occurrence in the Torah community. Women who cannot produce an egg that's successful will make use of donated eggs. And therefore, it's been our custom here in America, based upon the ruling of my father-in-law Zatzal, Moshe Feinstein, they always went through a conversion process soon after birth. Yeah, I am most likely the leading expert in drowning little children in the mikveh. I've never converted, it's once in Russia, but never converted an adult in America. All my conversions have been under 3 months. Yeah. Soon after The baby is born, we take him right away to the mikveh. Then regular conversion, some unique halachic issues that are not to discuss now. A woman is not an incubator. A woman exchanges cells with the baby. I'm sorry, the gestational mother. That exchange of cells most likely is necessary. Just a side comment. Why doesn't the mother reject the baby as foreign protein? Why doesn't the baby react to the mother, rejecting the mother's protein? You couldn't do a transplant from a mother to a child or a child to a mother. It'll be rejected. So Kodesh Baruch Hu, in his wisdom, most likely has that desensitization that goes on. A few little cells go one way, a few cells the other way, and like the allergist does, he desensitizes you to hay fever by giving you little injections. Yeah. But this raises more significantly the question, then how is it that today practically everyone is yelling DNA motherhood is only the one that counts? And practically all the poskim are insisting on DNA and not on gestation. I like to use the imagery. If you wanted to build a house in Muncie, many new homes are coming up. They're all occupied by Hasidim, of course. Yeah, you can tell that because there's no space between the houses, despite our zoning laws. Yeah. Want to build a house, you go to an architect, gives you a blueprint. Then you have to hire someone to put the house up. Then you need carpenters, you need plumbers, right, electricians, etc. Who made the major contribution to your home? The one who gave you the blueprint, or the contractor that put together the sink and the toilet and the heat and the electricity? Who built the house? That analogy applies to the difference between a gestational mother and a DNA mother. A DNA mother just gave a blueprint. And then this gestational mother had to put together the kidneys and the liver and the heart and the brain, etc. It was simple, non-halachic, non-scientific analysis. What we say is, the way a simple individual would understand, of course, the most important contribution is made by the gestational mother that for 9 months had to build the human body. Nevertheless, it still remains an issue that has not been resolved in halacha, even though, as I say, glibly, people say the DNA mother should be granted. So a little girl is running around on the beach in Miami Beach, right? And she receives a call from somebody to telling her, Mazel Tov, you just became a mother. Why? Because your egg, which was sold for some $25,000, not one egg, they usually super ovulate these young women, so they take out 20 eggs or 21 eggs, right? And therefore, now this baby was born, and it's your mother, it's your baby. You are the mother. I would still vote for gestational motherhood lahalocha, and nevertheless cover by doing, if it involves an egg from a non-Jewish mother, make sure to do a conversion as soon as possible. this is just a continuation of that point. Right. Can people see that clearly?
Yeah.
Okay. The program lists that my typhoid has been mitochondrial disease. Fortunately, we had an analysis of mitochondrial disease just before. I was so superb, it doesn't need anything added to it. God watches over his fools, so I was fortunate enough to think that maybe I would broaden my topic and maybe touch upon mitochondrial disease there, because of its, I think, historic significance, despite the fact that indeed it was not a modification of the nucleus of the mother. We didn't go ahead and tamper with the nucleus, but yes, we did. The fact is that this was a passing of a red line when the British Medical Association approved to do the mitochondrial repair. They were dealing with the nucleus. They didn't deal with that part of the nucleus that makes you look the way you look, or maybe think the way you think. But the fact is, the mitochondrial genes were part of the nucleus. They entered that nucleus. They entered the cell, modified the cell, and modified it permanently so that the next generation would not be the same genetic makeup as the first generation. And that was a major, thank you, that was a major, major step to be taken. And now, the next issue is, what more can you do to a nucleus, where I'm going to deal now with that part of the genes that determine how you look and how you think and how you behave. And that's where the gene editing issue comes in. That number, by the way, 1 in 6,500 children have that problem. I believe in America it's more than that. It's closer to 12,000, some 12,000 cases in which the mitochondria are defective, not allowing that individual to live a normal life. Happening now. Okay. And that's what raised that issue. Three parents, one baby, not at all. Something from Wall Street Journal this past February that I clipped in preparation for my bioethics class, which I'm teaching next semester there. Not really so. Yeah. But this article says that they didn't do anything to the nucleus. It's the real nucleus, right? But that's really not true. The mitochondria are critical for the survival of that child. The fact that it involves a smaller number of genes, mitochondrial genes, not with so-called nuclear genes, that doesn't make any difference. Without the mitochondria, you can't survive. You can't measure a contribution by the physical size of the contribution, but by its physiological activity. Without the mitochondria functioning properly, the individual is defective, providing that mitochondria makes that contribution a parental contribution, same as anything else. Yeah. And therefore, it's a major, major breakthrough there. And what happens? Who is the real mother? Will the real mother stand up? We don't know who the real mother is. Decision has to be made first on the issue of DNA versus gestation. Now you're contributing another issue, namely providing not DNA, but providing an energy mechanism for that child, critical as any other aspect of life. What will the halacha say? I don't know. It's right now, there's no basis for making that decision. I don't see any source in halacha to be able to make that decision. And the issue would be, for example, the one who provides the good mitochondria, is she a relative? And are the families now have to be careful for consanguinity? They shouldn't intermarry those and be in violation of halacha. You don't know. You need more wisdom to come from Kodesh Baruch Hu before we can decide on that one. Which brings us to gene editing. And gene editing is for real. Here you're going to go in to the nucleus and pull out a gene, maybe put in a gene, and permanently mutate that individual so that all subsequent generations will carry this new genome, this new makeup. And questions that have to be asked are in that next slide. Which, how does it go here? I didn't see what you, I have two slides. I'm here, what do you have? Yeah. Namely, evaluate what you want to do. Is it doing good? Are you doing any harm? Is it fair to society, justice? Is it made available, if it's good, made available to everybody? And number four, autonomy. Autonomy, of course, what is autonomy? Autonomy is God. Today, autonomy is God, right? There is no sin. There is no evil. There is no good, there is no bad. What I want, that's what's good. What I don't want, that's what's bad. Who is God? The one you see in the mirror. That's become our new theology throughout the world. That's called autonomy. The God of autonomy dominates now. Well, if you check that all, up to number four, it's pretty well, this is the Modeh Ani L'fanecha that every bioethicist says every morning. He mumbles to himself, right? Beneficence and omnificence, justice, right, and autonomy. But then came Kodesh Baruch Hu and gave us a Torah and threw in to the mix something called sanctity of life. The sanctity of life, better word is Kedusha Sachayim, right? There's a holiness to life, which takes away some of the other considerations, puts a new color onto everything. And just a comment, that's the synthetic future. Can we create what we want out of synthetic biology? Most likely we can already. No, almost surely we can. And what will be then? What if I can go to my shelf and mix and put together a DNA molecule and another DNA molecule and come up with, at minimum, one microbial cell? I will have created life. That's a challenge to Kodesh Baruch Hu? Not a challenge to Kodesh Baruch Hu. Yeah. Where did you get those things from the shelf? It's Kodesh Baruch Hu gave you those things from the shelf. And in them, in those bottles, lay a secret which Kodesh Baruch Hu, in his kindness, has able to reveal to us nowadays. and we know how to extract from those that bottles that Kodesh Baruch Hu gave us, we know how to extract a cell now. It is not a competition with the Rebbeinu Shel Olam, it's a fulfillment of the mitzvah of lasos, or the mitzvah of chibshuho, of mastering the world. I'm sure some of you must have picked it up, but I have in the next slide this mini enzyme, this Cas9 that came in and made of this mechanism that was already in use for many years, not too successfully, but in use, and now suddenly it became easy to do, to pull out a gene, to put in a gene there. This comment from Nature last April when it broke in this, a mini enzyme moves the gene editing closer to the clinic. This CRISPR is most likely the single most dramatic occurrence in bioscience of all times. Read there. It's from a June article in Nature. CRISPR, the disruptor, a powerful gene editing technology, is the biggest game changer to hit biology since PCR, when you could duplicate genes. But with its huge potential comes pressing concerns. Right. The pressing concerns are what you're doing now is forever after. Whatever change you make, you know, you changed something into something that never existed before. Are you sure that you've covered all the facets of this thing? You may not know, well, if I went ahead and I put a new gene in, is that gene friendly with the other genes? Remember, we have here a complex cell. Can you do that? Can you just throw a monkey wrench in? It looks like you fix things, but maybe only for one generation. And then as they start recombining, now will come out something horrendous out of it. That can only be answered by doing it under controlled conditions and doing it many times before you can allow it to go out into the public. So here you have, again, this economist that's only last month or so made it into the, this is now, The Economist is a British publication, but it's for the general public. It's not for scientists only. So look, what are they concerned with now? Once I could pull genes in and out, I'm worried about designer babies. I'm worried about people will now decide. An intelligent woman might wants to make sure that her son will get into a good university. But the trouble is he may be taking after his father and he's an idiot. So what I need to do is make sure he's 7.5 feet tall. 7.5 feet tall, at least make the basketball team. Right. And can I do that? Right. I want my son to be a chazan. Right. Yes, I want him to have perfect pitch. Right. Well, I have a gene for that one. Right. Et cetera, et cetera. What we have there. The bioethical concerns from a secular point of view is summarized here. Playing God, tampering with human DNA, right? And then as the secular literature picks it up, usually some nonsense, like number three, which is widely discussed now, violating the principle of autonomy. I told you autonomy is God. So the baby also has a God in him. Can you go ahead and modify the baby as you like it without asking the baby's permission? We have no problem from our vantage point. We know that Kodesh Baruch Hu gave parents the duty as well as the rights and the privilege of modifying their children the way they want. If we didn't modify the child, but let's wait till he's an adult and he'll decide whether he wants to be Jewish or not Jewish, whether he wants to go to yeshiva or not go to yeshiva. The Pirkei Avos speaks of an individual as a Pinchas Pasuach, as an open book. And Kol Masecha B'Sefer Nechtovim, and all you do is inscribed in that book. It's not exactly a true imagery, because no one gets a blank book. An individual gets a book in which the first chapters were written by parents. If the parents succeed, the proper parents succeed, then the child continues writing the book with the same storyline. And sometimes the child takes off and takes the book and puts in a new storyline that's not pleasing to parents and not pleasing to God. What's happening here now? Okay. The potential for clinical application of gene editing is really endless. Right. There, some examples are given. You can add to that list all the evils that befall mankind are open to change, because so much of what happens to us is determined by our genes. And modification of the genome, right, will modify almost every aspect of our life. And this is just to show you how it's made the preoccupation practically. This is from Nature of March there. People are frightened by gene editing, because it may take generations before you know whether he did harm or not. Okay, gene technology and its potential for good and evil, right? DNA altering trial triggers ethics alarm. And look at the next one. What do you do? Look at the date on this one. November 17th. That's last month, less than a month ago. What? A British toddler dying of aggressive form of leukemia. Right. Diagnosed that she was 3 months old and expect her to die in a few weeks. So what did they do? It doesn't say details what they did, but they went ahead and did what we call today, or what we're trying to call today, right, gene editing. And what happened, right? Several months after receiving an infusion of genetically engineered T cells, right, she was cured of this disease. Don't know how long it'll last, but that's called a miracle. So I'd like to comment on miracles. 2 points. One, a halachic point. The halacha says it's forbidden to pray for a miracle. I'll elaborate that in a minute. Well, we have one incident that occurred in our history. Right. That's the miracle that affirms the existence of God. In the Kuzari, this wonderful text that Yehuda Levi wrote, he has the king who's choosing a religion, and he's talking to the rabbi, and he asks the rabbi, "Who is your God?" And the rabbi answers, "The God who took me out of Egypt." So the king responds, "That was a stupid answer. Why didn't you say the God who made the world?" And Yehuda Levi, in the language of the rabbi, answers, "I don't know that God. I know the God who took me out of Egypt." One generation knew God. All later generations have to believe in God. I believe in God because my father told me he was there when God took him out of Egypt. We saw God in action. There was a Yediyas Hashem, no need for Emunas Hashem. Later on in Parshas Ekev, in the Torah, Kadosh Baruch Hu warns the Jewish nation, "Ki lo es b'neichem, asher lo yodu v'lo ro'u es musar Hashem." Not like you. You have an easy time to believe in me. You saw me master the world. I split the sea. I mastered the animals. Right? I mastered the sky and the heavens and the locusts, etc. So you know who I am. But your children will have to believe in me. Well, do we believe it? So we say, "Oh, Kriyas Yamsuf, they split the sea. That shows that God is, well, that's a miracle." So here, this is, by the way, I was in Okinawa. For many years, I was a civilian ethicist in the Navy. When the Navy had to be formed and they were required to go past the level of commander, they had to take a course in ethics. And I taught for 7 years, I taught the ethics course in the Navy there, and it was usually someplace in the Pacific Rim where we met. This was in Okinawa, and they imported a minion for me for Shabbos, in Okinawa. This is from the Navy newspaper that they put out every day, right? And they warn their people that if you want to go to see the sea split 4 times a year, you have to make reservations already because there's only one hotel on the island. What is it? 22 feet of water disappear 4 times a week, 4 times a year, and people rush in and pick up the crayfish and the lobsters, etc., etc. It stays out for 6-7 hours and then comes back. So what's the miracle of the splitting of the sea? There is no miracle. Well, that's what the Torah wants you to understand. There are no miracles. A miracle means a violation of the laws of nature. And the laws of nature are the orders of Kadosh Baruch Hu. God doesn't change our Torah. God doesn't change his natural laws. Our Chachamim make a reference, like Shinui HaTeva, a change in nature. There's no change in nature. There's Shinui in Yediyas HaTeva. The change is how we understand nature, but nature doesn't change. Here's the miracle of Kriyas Yamsuf. What did Kadosh Baruch Hu say? Right? Vayomer Elokim Yikovu Hamayim. Sorry, that's the next one. Vayomer Elokim Yikovu Hamayim. Right? Ani Hu Shesnesi. I am the one. What? Mitchila Shani Kovu. It didn't split now. It was built into the laws of nature. The tide at this time, the sun at this time, the moon at this time, right? Vayoshev hayom lifnos boker le'esano. The waters came back to their strength. So it says, no, spell that esano a little differently. Not esano, litno shesnesi imo mitzchila. Because there was no change in nature. It had to be built into nature to happen. And what was a miracle? Coincidence was a miracle. that just as the Egyptians are chasing me, just at that point, the coincidence of time was the miracle. But nature doesn't change. It had to be built into the laws of nature for the ocean to move away at that time, just as in Korea, the ocean does that four times a year. And here I want to show you what's happening. Okay. Here, a wonderful article in which someone who's in the field is urging, but be careful, you will possibly mess up nature, right? What was she worried about? If you can see it there, worried about if I'm going to go ahead and work with mosquitoes in order to make it impossible for them to transmit malaria, then I may change their genome into something which will be detrimental to nature. So what happens, here the date is May, what's going on here? What happened now? This is in May, she puts in this complaint. This Lunshof was working in gene editing, right? So what happens there? Look at the next one, right? And over here, what's the date? You can't see it, but that date is 2 weeks ago, or 3 weeks ago, right? That what they did, they modified the mosquitoes, and that they cannot transmit malaria anymore. And something happened. It spread quickly, not following the normal expectation. It spread quickly among all the mosquitoes that they had. And now the belief is the mosquitoes will go out and compete successfully with the wild type mosquitoes. And thus minimize the occurrence, the incidence of malaria in the world. I was not aware of the fact that in animal husbandry, look at the date on this next one. Give you an idea of the pace, right? How are we doing on time? I wasn't aware that in raising cattle, they always dehorn the cattle. They shouldn't kill each other. So someone got a bright idea. There's only one gene that determines the horn, right? I'll go ahead and look what happened. Here's the mother cow on the left, right? And there are the two calves already, no horns. While we're debating the ethics of everything, it's tearing ahead. Therefore, I want to now raise a critical halachic issue there. None of this is going to progress without doing over and over again the experimental work, and then ultimately go through the whole rigmarole of phase one, phase two, phase three studies in order to be able to determine whether it's good or bad. So here there's the halachic issue. Is a Jew required to participate in all these many, many trials, taking into account as minimum damage, minimum potential of damage, but do we have an obligation to participate in all the trials that have to go on in order to allow science to advance? So we're short on time. I'll have to shorten this thing there. Okay, here you have, it says Abraham, you see the on Yud Gimel, it says Abraham when he returned, when he continued on his travels, He always stayed in the same hotel. Why? To teach you that that's what you're supposed to do. Why? Because if I want motels to exist in this world, there has to be some loyalty to the motel owner. He'll keep a motel if the customers keep on coming back. If everybody's going to open up a motel and you go to each motel for once, no motel owner is going to be able to maintain a motel. He has to be able to build up clientele. So it's a duty in the name of Avraham for people to make sure there are good motels in the world. Here you have Yaakov Avinu, right? Vayishlach, only last week, week before this, right? It says, Vayichan as Paneo Ir. He came to a town and he did something. So what did he do? So look in the Rav, see if I can catch that thing. Okay. What did he do? Right? Yeah. Right? He taught them how to use coins. Shvul Omar, right? Shvokim, he taught them how to set up a marketplace, a shuk, right? The other says he taught them how to build bathhouses. Doesn't say he taught them Torah. That, of course, he did. That was his normal activity. But he had a duty to contribute to society. From here we learn a halachic obligation that we are to contribute to society as well. And I say it requires a little more attention to this, but another aspect comes in. We care what the Jew is thought about in the non-Jewish world. We're afraid of Eivah. Eivah doesn't only mean enmity. It means lack of respect, lack of appreciation, etc. And there I quote from the Igros Moshe, there where he points out that the reason why a doctor can treat a non-Jewish patient on Shabbos is not because we love the non-Jews. No, the halacha is simple. And once upon a time, I could sell that to a non-Jew. Your religion doesn't allow it, my religion does allow it. People understood religion was a dominant force in their lives. But today it's no longer so. And if we explain, I love you very much, but I can't treat you on Shabbos because I have my Shabbos to worry about. Come on Sunday, I'll take care of you. It will not sell. You can't do it. Therefore, we allow you to transgress the Shabbos to treat a non-Jew. The reason is Mishum Eva, because you have to be a member of society. And unless you are a member of society and contribute to society, you will be an outcast of society. We cannot live that way. That was not Kodesh Baruch Hu's intent. That requires more elaboration, but time doesn't permit. Yeah. And just one last comment that I must make. Okay. Where does prayer fit in? I'm going to do a gene editing. It's no problem. After that, I will sit and say a kapitel tilim, right? And I'll daven well, so it'll all go well. Can you count on that or not? Right? What's the role of tefillah? So we know a strange thing. In his Gemara in the Doron says that Rabbi Akiva's Talmud, a student of Rabbi Akiva, was ill and people did not visit him. Rabbi Akiva came and contributed to him, etc., etc. Then the Ran, that's underlined there on the left column, and I'll say it in English, right? The Ran says, here's what Rabbi Akiva said to his students, why didn't you go visit this man? You could have helped him. And if you couldn't have helped him because he's so sick, you should have prayed that he should die. Pray he should die? Why didn't he say he should pray? You should pray for him. He said, no. If there's no hope by medical science for a person to live, then it's forbidden to pray he should live. You have to pray he should be comfortable dying. Why? Because you can't pray for a miracle. Right here, under it, it's also lismo chalanes, right? You can't pray for a miracle. Pray for a miracle. So what do you do about this? Right? Here you have a case of a patient, right, with advanced bladder cancer, and a whole bunch of people received the same drug to no avail, and this person was cured. Isn't that a miracle? Why can't you pray for a miracle? Here, look at the next one that I found, right? A fellow's dying of a glioblastoma, no cure. And he steps on a nail, and they give him a shot of tetanus toxin, toxoid, right? And the tumor goes away. No one's ever cured of a glioblastoma. Is that a miracle? No, it's not a miracle. There's no such miracles. God doesn't make miracles. God makes miracles b'derech hateva. What's the miracle? The miracle is, we just revealed a new aspect that we didn't know before, and people jumped on it right away. Oh, a shot of tetanus cured him. Maybe it stimulated the immune system. Let's go back and study the immune system again and see how we can find something there that will be of help. This is, then, you can't pray for a person who's dying to live, but I can pray that his doctor should read the literature and find a cure that didn't occur before. I pray that PhD in the university laboratory should have a breakthrough. I can pray for what? So therefore, I will conclude with this dramatic statement. Right. If you want to pray for someone who's terribly sick, don't pray Refa'enu Hashem b'nei rofe, because it's a futile prayer. Oh, I stepped on something again. It's a futile prayer. I shouldn't pray Refa'enu. That's how I still understand. The prayer I should give is Ata Chonein Lodam Das. God, please give us additional wisdom so we can discover a cure for that disease. That's a proper prayer, because we know that the capability of the human mind is limitless. We're only waiting for Kadosh Baruch Hu to allow us to pursue it further. And therefore, it's a little disturbing when you get in the mail every single week, right, an appeal, right? What's the appeal? If you'll give me money, right? I received this on November 28th. If you'll give me money, I will have prayer of the Gedolei Ador at the time of the lighting of the Hanukkah candles, or I will pray with Kohanim Minyan, right? And there, the prices vary. For the plain Gedolim is only $36. For a Minyan of Kohanim, right, it's $72. For 8 days of Hanukkah praying, it's $120. That makes fun of Kadosh Baruch Hu and his Torah. Makes fun of what tefillah is supposed to be. Tefillah is supposed to be a pleading with Kadosh Baruch Hu, right, for his kindness in helping me find a cure for an illness, solve my problems, b'derech hateva, through natural law. Thank you.